Hello everyone, welcome to Promote Music Atmosphere, the serial lecture of 10th anniversary of Peking University Chinese Music Institute. Today's topic is about computational methods for Jingju music research, the CompMusic project. You know, the young discipline of music information retrieval has experienced a remarkable growth and development during its two decades of existence. However, most of its research has focused on contemporary Western commercial music, which might cast its bias. And the CompMusic, the aim of this project is to tackle this bias and at the same time to benefit from the new research problems posed by different music traditions. The CompMusic project, funded by the European Research Council and carried out at the Music Technology Group of Universitat Pompeu Fabra, applies a data-driven, culturally specific approach to the research in five music traditions, including Chinese Jingju music. And in this presentation, CompMusic's general PI professor, Xavier, Serra, and two of its researchers, Rafael Caro and Zhang Shuo, will explain the potential of computational methods for Jingju music research.
大家晚上好，欢迎来到韶润燕园中院学社10周年社庆公益系列讲座的现场。今天讲座的主题是运用计算机方法分析京剧音乐。 大家都知道，音乐信息检索是一个融合了计算机科学、数字信号处理、音乐学、人工智能等科学的新兴研究方向。为了填补音乐信息检索研究在非西方传统音乐的空白， 2011年， 欧洲研究理事会出资启动了以西班牙庞贝法布拉大学音乐技术研究组为中心的一个 CompMusic项目。 此项目呢，主要采用以数据为准、以特定文化为导向的方法，对世界五种文化的传统音乐进行分析。 此次讲座将由项目负责人、西班牙庞贝法布拉大学信息与通信技术系的副教授 Professor Xavier Serra 以及他的两名研究员 Rafael Caro 和张硕来介绍他们的研究成果，并讨论音乐信息检索技术在京剧音乐分析和处理中的应用。下面让我们有请 Xavier Serra 教授上台为我们进行本次讲座。Welcome.
Good afternoon, everyone. From the introduction, I am Xavier Serra, and I am responsible for the CompMusic project. And we are very glad to be here. We thank the organizers for this invitation. It's a big pleasure. This is not my first time here. I was here 3 years ago when this project started. And that was the time that I was looking around the world for music traditions that would be interesting to study for our project. And I decided that Jingju music was a very good candidate for that. So we started working on that, and I come here 3 years later to explain a little bit of our initial results and to try to maybe find some possible collaborations and people that might be interested in helping us in this project. So the project we are, as was mentioned, we are three people here, myself, Rafael Caro, and Zhang Shuo. This is the work of many other people. Some are also working on Beijing Opera, and some are working on other music traditions. But the tools and the research we're doing also is adapted from other traditions. So the presentation that we will do incorporates some work from a number of researchers of the group, and this is the list of researchers. So before starting to talk about the project, let me briefly introduce our research group and where we come from. So we are at the Universitat Pompeu Fabra in Barcelona. Maybe you know where Barcelona is. We are aware that maybe for many people, Barcelona is only known for the football team. But apart from the football team, there are other things there, like the Pompeu Fabra University. And that's where we are. And this is where our offices are and where we teach the classes. Okay, so the Music Technology Group, well, it's one of the biggest groups internationally that focuses on music. from an engineering perspective. And it's part of an engineering department. It's part of a Department of Information and Communication Technologies. But given that our focus is music, we collaborate strongly with conservatories, with musicians, and with musicologists. So it's in that respect, it's a very interdisciplinary research group. We are more than 50 people doing research in this area, and that includes people coming from different backgrounds. In fact, Rafael Caro, who is one of the researchers, comes from ethnomusicology, and in fact, Zhang Shuo comes from both musicology and linguistics. So these are very important interdisciplinary contributions to our research. In terms of education, well, the undergraduate, we are basically teaching engineering courses, even though, again, we are involved in other activities in the conservatory. But at the graduate level, which is where normally the research starts happening, we have a master's in sound and music computing, and it's a very international master. In fact, we have quite a number of Chinese people coming to these masters, and also people from many countries around the world. And then we have a PhD program that is very much an engineering PhD program, but of course people do the work within the group, and therefore they do research in music technology. In terms of research areas, the area of music technology has expanded a lot in the last few years. It used to be much narrower. It used to be, for example, when I did my PhD at Stanford in the 80s, it was basically focused on sound synthesis and developing of musical synthesizers. That was the typical outcome of the research in music technology. Nowadays, it covers many other things. And in fact, one of the areas that has been expanding the most is the area that we'll be talking about today, which is the area of music information retrieval. So in our group, we work on audio signal processing, which is maybe one of the core areas. That's where my background comes from. But the work I am presenting today is relating with this field that we call music information retrieval that I will introduce. Then lately, because of all the internet and all the semantic web, a big area of research relates with semantic web technologies applied to music, and we are starting to do a lot of things there. And also, we do quite a few research projects related with interfaces, with developing instruments, developing interfaces for making music or for interacting with music. So in order to make that a little bit clear, let me just highlight a few projects that we have done in the past, and that might give you an idea of what this means in real practice. So some older projects, for example, Vocaloid, maybe some of you know about that, at least in some countries, especially Japan, that's a very well-known virtual singer. We developed the technology for Yamaha that supports this singing synthesizer. So it's a singing voice technology that then there has been a number of voices, maybe Hatsune Miku, is the most famous one. I guess in Chinese you say another name, but in Japanese is Hatsune Miku. So anyway, so that's one project that we have done, and on singing voice we have done a lot of things. Another project is the React Table. React Table is a musical instrument, is a table, and in which there are objects that you interact with, and that you can make synthesis sounds with. So it's meant mainly for electronic music. And this became especially known because some known musicians have been using it. For example, Björk, this singer from Iceland, and she did a tour using that instrument, and because of that, it became quite known within the circles of electronic music. And then another project that I wanted to mention is a website that we use as a platform for doing research, which is freesound.org. This is a website in which people upload sounds, and then anyone can use them. One of the challenges in our field is access to recordings of either sounds of music. We do a lot of research and all the people that do electronic music, they do a lot of creative work using sounds. And because of the copyright issues, that becomes a big problem. So we started this project in order to overcome that by using a legal framework that is called Creative Commons that allows people to upload sounds and use a special license that allows other people to use it legally. And therefore, it's a good framework for sharing sounds and for doing research and also for doing creative work. Okay, and then more recent projects that I just want to highlight. One is a project that we have been developing with Cork. Cork is another Japanese company that one of their lines of products relate with tuners, music instrument tuners, the ones that you use to tune your instrument. So with them, we are trying to develop the next generation of tuners. Tuners that not only tell you if you play in tune, but also tell you if the sound that you produce is good. So Cortosia is an app for the iPhone now that measures the sound that you produce in your instrument and tells you if the sound quality that you produce, according to different dimensions that we have defined, is good enough. And of course you can say, okay, but that's a very subjective concept. It's something that cannot be defined in an absolute way. Your teacher may like one sound and another teacher may like another sound. So in order to solve that, we do machine learning using this website in which people upload sounds similar to free sound, and then people vote on the sound. So there is a concept of a community that decides what is a good sound for them. And therefore, what Cortosia tells you is the concept of a good sound according to a community, according to a set of people, musicians, that agree on a certain concept. Anyway, so that's another project. And finally, the last one I want to mention is Acoustic Brains. Acoustic Brains is another website in which we are gathering music, well, strictly speaking, the analysis of music. As I mentioned before, one of the challenges in our field is to access to recordings. And it's impossible to share recordings of commercial music. Because of copyright issues, commercial music cannot be shared among researchers or even freely online. But we can share the analysis of the music. Okay? So what this website does is crowdsources the analysis of music. So people upload the analysis that has been done using some free software that we have developed. It's a library called Essentia. People download the library and then they upload the analysis done from that. And in a few months that this has been going on, there are more than 2 million tracks, 2 million songs already analyzed. So that's a pretty good initiative that then, again, this can be used for research. So now let's go more into the music information retrieval, which is the area in which we want to emphasize our talk today. And music information retrieval is it's quite a recent area of research that comes from a very common problem that we have, all of you have, and which is how to find music online, how to find music on the web, or how to search music on your hard disk, and how to organize and find music that you like. And therefore, this area of research comes from, okay, let's try to use all that information about music, not just the recordings that exist online or that exist on your hard disk. Let's analyze it and let's automatically structure it. Let's automatically add some information that facilitates your search and the kinds of things you want to do with your music. And the typical application that can come out of that, and that is the one that has driven the research that we'll be talking about is the idea, for example, of iTunes. iTunes is a common player that I'm sure many of you use to play the music that you have on your hard disk. You put all the MP3s and you use that to organize and play the music. So we would like to claim that we can do better than this, that iTunes is excellent, but we can do much better. And from a research perspective, we can add information to this type of thing automatically that would allow you to do things that you are now cannot think of, okay? And basically what we'll be talking today is using the case of Jingju, how can we really do an iTunes for Jingju music that adds some functionality that maybe you have never thought of and that might be very useful for you. And when we think about iTunes, and when we think about these type of technologies, which are, I guess, these are information technologies, typically we have this in mind. This is the typical picture that most companies have in mind when developing information technologies. This is the Facebook links, so all the connections that happen in Facebook and all the transactions and the information, how it flows. I guess you can notice that there is an historical error in this picture. Maybe some of you have already noticed that is China is not here, but this is not a technological problem. This is another type of problem. But the problem I want to emphasize here is the fact that we are considering all these technologies as completely global, as completely independent of the country, completely independent of the information it handles. We just consider a technology that covers the whole world in the same way. And if we look at one technology specific for music, for example, Amazon. Amazon is a portal that sells, maybe it's not that popular in China, but around the world it's very popular, that sells books, sells music, sells many things. And basically, the technology that supports Amazon is the same everywhere. You go to the Amazon in China, or Amazon in Japan, or in France, or in the US, and the back end, and even the front end, even the design of this website is exactly the same everywhere. The language may change, the content may change, but what is the technology, what are the information technologies supporting this is the same, okay? And I claim that this is wrong, that we can do better than that. And I didn't know that a few years ago, in fact, I realize very consciously that, maybe you were aware of that, but I was not. And I was invited to India to give a series of talks on music information retrieval, on the technologies to analyze and discover music. Okay, and then there in India, I had a lot of students, and many of them were very interested also in music, in Indian music. And when I was describing the type of research that we were doing and that was the state of the art internationally, I realized that it was not so useful to them, that their music was not well represented, that was not well supported by the technologies that were being developed and are being developed internationally to analyze and organize music. So Indian music cannot be properly discovered with the current technologies. So I came back to Spain with the idea that I had to do something about it, that we could do better, that we could try to look for technologies, to develop new technologies that would be appropriate for Indian music and some of these music traditions that are very important around the world, but that do not follow the Western pop, Western classical model, which is where we put the emphasis when we think about music research from an engineering perspective. Of course, musicologists, ethnomusicologists have been looking at these things, but engineers, I guess, we don't know much about these things, and we are just focusing on Western music.
So this is how the CompMusic project started.
I applied to a grant to the European Research Council with this idea that I just mentioned, and I was lucky enough to get it. So this started close to 4 years ago, and now I have 2 more years to continue this research. And I have been able to put together a group of researchers that are working on these topics, some on these different countries that we are working on. Of course, it's a very ambitious project, and we haven't been able yet to do everything what we wanted, but we're doing good progress. The first issue that we had to solve and make a decision on was what music traditions should we focus on. Of course, we couldn't do all the musics of the world. That would be impossible. So we had to identify certain music traditions that would be adequate for the task that we wanted, which was basically to push the technologies in new directions, to look for musics that were very different from the Western music, that we knew enough about them that we could use the research from musicology to be able to develop algorithms, engineering, computer science type of tools that would work on that. So since this idea came to me when I was in India, so I had to include the two Indian traditions. There are two strong classical traditions in India, the one from the south, which is the Carnatic music tradition, and the one from the north, which is the Hindustani. I don't have time to really go into that because we will focus on the Jingju music, but let me just at least play a little bit of that music. So this was Carnatic music, and let's play a bit of Hindustani music. Okay, so apart from the Indian traditions, another one that we chose was the Ottoman. This is a music tradition from Turkey, from the Ottoman Empire, so centered in Istanbul. That was a music tradition that developed for many years and has been very influential in also both in Eastern European countries and in Arabic countries. So it's very still very much active and alive in Turkey, especially in the area around Istanbul. So let me play that. Thank you.
Okay, and then another tradition was the Arab Andalusian music, and in fact this tradition, I chose it, I would say, basically because of a guilt problem, personal one, because I didn't know much about this one, and in fact it was born where now Spain is. Spain was an Arab and Islamic country for many centuries, and it was called Al-Andalus, and was basically the center of the cultural activities of a lot of the Arab countries. And this musical tradition was born there in between the 8th and the 13th century. But of course, the Christians kicked out all the Arabs and the Jews from Al-Andalus, and they are now very much alive in the north of Africa. So this tradition is now maintained in Morocco, Algeria, Tunis. That's what is called the Maghreb. And it's a very interesting music tradition. So it has been, for me, a great experience to learn about this, and it's a very particular type of music. I didn't know much about Chinese music, but I knew that it was very different from Western popular music and Western classical music. That much I knew. So I came here and I spent a month, mainly here in Beijing and other parts, trying to look or select what music tradition could I use from China that would be adequate for our research. So I became very interested in a number of things. Here, I was very interested with Kuching music. I didn't know much or didn't know anything about Kuching music. And I really fell in love with the instrument and the music. But I also liked very much Beijing opera. And given a number of constraints or characteristics of the project, with Rafael, we decided that it was more appropriate to focus on Beijing opera. Hopefully you all have heard a little bit of Beijing opera. So, and we'll play some examples. Now Rafael will play some examples, so I'm not gonna play that now. Okay, so what do we do with all these music traditions? What type of research do we do? As I said, there is a lot of researchers involved, a lot of PhD students are doing research on specific topics, but most of the research, maybe even all the research, can be fit into this diagram. Okay, so we start from data. We do analysis from analyzing information. So we analyze the recordings, and we analyze the information that accompanies those recordings that can be found online in Wikipedia, or all the information that is the editorial metadata that accompanies the CDs and that we put in a website called Music Brains, and some other information. So this is the data we start from. Originally, we thought that that would be easy to find that data. Then it has been much harder than what we expected. So a lot of effort in the project has been to gather that information. And Rafael will talk about the issue of the in Jingju music, how we have done that. But our research is mainly on the middle part here. This is the engineering research. The areas of engineering that we focus on are signal processing, machine learning, and semantic analysis. Today in the talk, we are mainly going to focus on signal processing, machine learning type of problems or technologies that we have been using. But of course, this is at the service of trying to understand some musically relevant concepts. Okay, these are the musical relevant concepts we have decided to focus on. There could be many others, but we had to narrow down. So we focus on melodic analysis, trying to identify characteristics, melodic characteristics of the music, trying to identify rhythmic characteristics of the music, and finally, trying to identify relationships between concepts that appear in a given music tradition, entities, the difference between, let's say, two artists, or the difference between two compositions, or different theoretical aspects of a music tradition. But apart from this core research that we do, which I guess a PhD thesis has to contribute to one of these core aspects, we want, as part of the project, to make tools that can be of use to people. And especially we are focusing on people that are music lovers of the traditions that we studied for, and therefore that we can make tools that a music lover of Jingju music can use to learn better than music, to learn to appreciate better than music. We are talking about music traditions that are classical, that have an intellectual aspect to it that would be beneficial to appreciate best that music tradition, to understand some details, some have some analytical approach to that music. So hopefully, and what you will see is the initial results on that, we are going to be able to develop some tools for that. This is a website, one of the tools, the main tools we are developing, called Dunia, that allows us to explore, to navigate through a music collection in ways, as related with what I said at the beginning, that hopefully add some added value, add some new ways of exploring, navigating the music, compared with what we have nowadays, compared with iTunes, or we compare with other type of tools that people use to explore music. Okay, and with that, now I want to give the floor to Rafael, that he will drive us to the research on Jingju music, the first part, and then Zhang Shuo will continue on that. Thank you.
Okay, so from now on, I will be talking about the research we've carried out on Jingju music. So as Professor Serra said, the first step for this kind of research is to gather a corpus on which to work. So this, in the upper picture, this is our music corpus. These are all the CDs we've gathered for carrying out this project. To gather this corpus, we have three criteria. The first one is that we want to focus on traditional repertoire, on traditional pieces, so we can study the traditional concepts of Jingju music. So we are not considering new compositions, the new historical compositions, simply Shijiu, or the contemporary composition, Xiantaixi. We're focusing on contemporary, traditional repertoire. The second criterion is that we need recordings with good sound quality, because we're working with computers. So all these recordings from the 20s to the 60s, we cannot use those. So we have our corpus contains recordings from more or less the 80s onwards. And the third criterion is that we're taking the aria chantuan as our unit for analysis. So all these recordings of the whole play, or VCDs, DVDs, we are not using those either, because it would be much more effort to use it. So according to these three criteria, this is the corpus we have gathered, which is over 100 CDs and over 650 arias. But this corpus is growing. For example, a few days ago, we went to a theater and found new CDs that we didn't have, and we bought it. So it's increasing. Okay, so from these CDs, we extract the related information, the so-called metadata, which is the actor or actress who sings, the title of the recording, the title of the CD, and everything that is related to the music. And we put this information in this website, Music Brains. This is a an open website where everyone can upload information about recording music, and everyone can use this information. So we use this platform in order to have our metadata well arranged, well organized, and to access our metadata in a very efficient way. This platform wasn't designed for this kind of music, so there is no system yet to upload information like Bashi or Shenqiang or Handan. But we have a close collaboration with the developers of the website, and we hope to be able to upload this information in the future. Okay, then our corpus also contains scores, music scores. We have bought some collections of Peking Opera of Jingju music scores. The problem is they are printed versions, they're in paper. So we cannot use these scores with the computers right now. We have to find a way to convert these scores to some machine readable format so that we can use these scores with the computer. So we have found some software, but this would be a big work to type of these scores to new versions. So we're thinking about it. And finally, our corpus also includes some music features extracted from the music. We use a library of algorithms developed in our team called Essentia, which is open, and we extracted many features from the recordings and added them to our corpus, so we can use with them also. Okay, so once we have this corpus, we have to use to develop tools for the analysis of Jingju music. And this is the content of our talk today. But before going into detail with that, I would like to do two remarks. So first, these tools are not aimed at replacing the work of musicologists. So these tools, to give them a tool for make their work easier, or to make it, to enhance the kind of analysis they do. For example, by adding some quantitative data to the qualitative, usually qualitative analysis that musicologists do. Or for example, to let them apply analysis to big amount of data, to large corpora. Or hopefully helping them find new problems to tackle, but not to replace their work. And secondly, our talk is not about Jingju music. We are not experts on this music. We're gonna be presenting the tools that we're developed to analyze this music and see what is the potential of these tools, but we are not talking about the music. And probably we will say some mistakes about the music, so please forgive us and if you can't correct us. Okay, so let's go. To present these tools, I would take this recording as an example, this aria sung by Li Shenzhu from this opera in CTA. I will be applying these tools to this recording so you can see the kind of analysis we can do. And here you have a summary of all the different tasks we think we can apply to Jingju music. For example, we first can segment the music automatically. So segment the music into musical relevant sections. For example, the sections with luogu, with percussion, or sections that are only instrumental, the guomen, and also the sections where singing on them, the so-called chanxian parts. And then once we have these different sections, we can apply a specific analysis to them. For example, in the sections with luogu, with percussion, we can automatically identify the luogu jin, the percussion patterns. Or we can use the sections with only instrumental part, the guomen, to determine the tuning of the Jinghu, or the most predominant instrument in the accompaniment ensemble. Or our research focused mostly on the singing part, because we analyzed Jingju music, and Jingju music is expressed in the singing. And we can use this part, for example, to compare the performance of two actors. To do that, first we extract the predominant melody, so the singing line. And once we have this line, we can plot, for example, pitch histograms, from where we can analyze the intonation or the range. I put some examples later to make it clear. From this melodic line, we can also analyze the vibrato or the loudness, or we can or timbre, or we can study the relationship between the linguistic tones and the melody, which is the work that Zhang Shuo does. And we can use also this melody to compare two different melodies and see how similar they are. So these kind of analyses are from the second segmentation, but we can also do other things like tracking the beats for in the rhythm. And when we have the beats, we can measure the tempo, the speed of the beats. And hopefully, with that information, we can automatically identify which pashi is being sung in this section. Other kind of work is taking the lyrics, which are easily accessible in the web. There is many repositories of lyrics in the web. We can take the lyrics and align them with the audio. And we can say the same with the scores, align them with the audio. So we can listen to the audio and have the lyrics and the score aligned at the same time. We hope we can find a system to do automatic transcription of the music. So going from the recording to a musical score. And finally, we're also researching how to develop this tool that Professor Serra presented before, called Tunia, which is our suggestion of probably an improvement of the iTunes. So all these tasks, this summary is a research plan. We cannot claim that any of these tasks is fully completed now. So we have many researchers working in different tasks. And in fact, for some of them, we are just in a very initial stage. But these are the kind of tasks we think are possible to do, and that's we'd like to present them here. Okay, so let's go one by one through them. Previously, I don't have any engineering background. I'm trying to get there. I'm a musicologist. So there's some kind of terminology that was very hard for me. For example, this one. So I'm trying to explain very briefly in case any of you is in the same situation as myself. So the first step is to go from the waveform, which is the way the music is stored in the computer, which is this sine wave, to go from there to a spectrogram, which is this kind of representation. So I will explain very briefly what is this. Here, we have two sounds. I play them. Okay, these two sounds have the same pitch, C4, the same duration and the same loudness, but they are different, they sound different because of the timbre. So we can represent timbre in this way. This is the spectrum of this sound. We have here the representation of all the harmonics of this sound for the violin and for the flute. And we see that in both sounds, the relative weight of each harmonic is different. So the structure of the harmonics have a different shape in the two sounds. So that was a simplification, and this is the real representation of this sound. Okay, but these were just single sounds. We're analyzing melodies. For example, here we have a short example of a cello melody. Let's play it. Okay, so this spectrum is just the representation of the first sound of this melody. What happens if we want to represent the whole melody? So what we do is to put the frequency analysis vertically and add horizontally the time domain. So here at the bottom, you can see the melody. And here vertically, you can see all the harmonics. and the different weight of each harmonic depends on the color. So the brighter the color, the most prominent. You see here, this harmonic is very prominent, so the color is very bright. And here, it's not that prominent, so the color is not that bright. So this is the basic concept of the spectrogram. Okay, but this is a very simple melody with only one instrument. This is the spectrogram for this whole recording, right? Which is much more complex, since we have the singing melody and we have all the instruments and the percussion. So this is the material from which we start our work. And I will be using this picture a lot. Okay, so let's go to the first task. We have the spectrogram of the whole recording, and from that, we want to get automatically the different segments according to musical relevance. For example, in this picture here, which was produced automatically, in red we have the sections where there is vocal percussion. In yellow we have the sections where there is just instrumental sections, the cuome. And in blue we have the parts with singing. So this was computed automatically, and now I'll play a short video to let you see how this was done. Okay. So firstly, we open, this is the track, and we open it with a software for music analysis. And we can compute with that very quickly and very easily the pitch histogram. So we can see here the whole pitch histogram. Then one of our students, which is a Chinese student doing his master there, implemented this code that is written in this form as a command line. And then you can see how the algorithm is computing the segmentation, and it produces a file. This file that can be loaded also to this software. And then here we go. We have here the segmentation computed automatically. And the different colors indicate the different sections. So in purple or red, we have the percussion, in yellow, the instrumental sections, and in green or blue, the singing. And we can listen to them separately. For example, this is the part with percussion. Sorry. Yeah. We can listen to the part with just instrumental part. And now part with singing line. Okay, so we have segmented this area automatically in different sections, and now we can use these sections to apply specific analysis to each of them. For example, we can start with the sections with percussion. So this algorithm has found these three sections as percussion, vocal. So one of our researchers had developed an algorithm to automatically identify which percussion pattern, which locutin, is played in each of these sections. And this algorithm has found that in the first one, there is a double hole. This algorithm. Let's listen to it. Yeah. In the second section, the algorithm found a manchan shui. Let's listen to it. Okay, so this was manchan shui, and at the end, there is a chu hou. Let me try to explain now how this algorithm found that, for example, this part, which is the first section with Roku, this is a double hole. So first we need to know where each instrument is playing. You will see the tamhiku, the wu, its energy is here, it's in this vertical line, but in this region we can see very clearly in this yellow color where the gu plays. Right? This is even more clear in the case of the xiao, the small gong, with this shape down, down, down. You can see this shape here, with all the harmonies, of course, but here in this region, the energy is more prominent. This is the same case for the nabo, for the cymbals. The energy is spread all over the spectrogram, but here in this region is more prominent. And the same for the talbo, the big gong, which is down, down, which is this shape at the bottom. So once we have found where each instrument starts, we can come to this kind of representation. And then we know where each instrument is played, and we can represent the percussion pattern and classify to according to sound representation we have previously done. So this can be done automatically, and we can use this kind of algorithms to, for example, search for percussion patterns in a collection. And that's our proposal for providing the musicologist a tool to apply analysis to a big corpus. For example, we took this collection, Tiju Rising, which has 30 CDs and more than 300 arias, and we searched within this collection for these five percussion patterns. And the algorithm found that within these 300 arias, there are these occurrences. And we can go deeper. For example, we can take Tuotuo, where there is 30 examples within this corpus, and then this algorithm will tell us specifically in which CD, in which track, at which second it starts, and how long it lasts. And with this information, we can do easily some analysis. For example, we can see here, in the first case, that Tuotuo lasts less than 5 seconds. Let's listen to that. And in this case, it's more than 8 seconds. Let's listen to it. Okay, so this is an example of how to apply an analysis easily to a large collection that would take a long time for a musicologist to do listening one of the 300 tracks to find this percussion pattern. Okay, so let's go now to another kind of section, which is the section with instrumental, only instrumental accompaniments, the guome. We have used these sections to compute the tuning of the jinghu, that is, which is the frequency of the neixian and the waixian. And we have seen that in this section, the neixian is a C sharp 5, and the waixian, the outer string, is a G sharp 5. We can listen to that. So this is the original track of the guome. Okay, so now we can synthesize the pitch for the neixian, the inner string, and listen at the same time with the original track and see if the result is accurate. And we can do the same with the outer string, with the waixian. Knowing that this aria, this chanduan, is in xipi, we can know that the first degree of the scale is in this pitch, E4, a little bit higher. and we can listen to it as well together with the original track. So this is another example of how applying these tools to this kind of analysis. Now we start with the part where we have focused more on, which is the part with singing, because we're analyzing the singing features of Jingju music. So the first step we have to do is to extract for the sections with singing the singing line, the melodic line, because it's the part we're interested in. We have also developed, one of our researchers have developed an algorithm for automatically extracting the predominant melody of this section. So I play a short video where we see how the algorithm extracts the melody from these two parts in blue, just for, as an example. So I'll play this. First, we open the track with the same program, and we load the segmentation we did before. And let's listen now to just these two parts. Okay, we run the algorithm for extracting a predominant melody, and the result is like this for this section. And we can listen the synthesized version to it. Let's listen to it. Once we have this melodic line, we can use this for many different types of analysis. In this case, I'm going to compare the performance of the same aria, still the same Marianne in CTA, sang by two different actresses, Li Shengzu and Chi Xiaoqiu. And these two actresses, each of them belongs to different schools, different liupai. Li Shengzu is from Meipai, Meilanfang school, and Chi Xiaoqiu is from Chenpai, Chen Yanqiu school. So we can use also this kind of tools to make a comparison of these two schools. The first method we tried is a pitch histogram. I will try to explain very briefly what a pitch histogram is. Here we have a very simple melody, La, Do, Re, Do. And we see here that each note has the same duration. So Do is sung twice, so it's more prominent in this melody than the other notes. We can get this information with this kind of representation. Here we have, let's say, the notes. And in this peak, we see that Do is sung twice as La and Do. And this also allows us to see the tuning of the notes. If, in case, for example, Re is sung higher, we'd see that here, because the peak would be displaced towards the right. Okay, let's see. This is the histogram of the singing of Li Shengzu, and the performance of Li Shengzu. We can see first that the most prominent note in this performance is La. So that the note that has been sung for a longer time, followed by So and Mi. Here in the x-axis, we have the equal temperament scale. And we can compare the tuning of this singer with this scale. Here, the thick red line is the first degree on the scale, and this is the higher octave of it. So if we compare these lines with the peaks, we see the tuning is very accurate compared with the equal temperament. But surprisingly, at least for us, is that the higher octave of the first degree is sung a little bit higher than in the equal temperament scale. We are not in a position to interpret this result. We need the collaboration of specialists to help us understand this. Perhaps it's a problem of our tools, or not, or perhaps it's a new task to research. We need some help for that. We can see also that in the case of Fa, is higher than the equal temperature scale, but we expected that. So in the bibliography we checked, there is this information. Okay, so now we can compare the pitch histograms from these two performances and see differences. For example, seeing in the same area, Chisiao-Chou, in the case of Chisiao-Chou, this note is the most prominent one, the higher octave red. So we see some melodic differences in the two performances. And now we can see also the shape of the peaks. And we can see in the case of Chisiao-Chou that they are very narrow and they're very clean compared to Li Shensu, which had more wider, had more different shapes. This could mean that Li Shensu has more ornamentation, more glissandi, or different kind of vibrato. So this is a tool for exploring this kind of aspects. And here at the bottom, we see the frequency of the first degree of the scale. And we can compare how in the case of Li Shensu, she sang a little bit higher than E4, and in case of Chisiao-Chou, she sang a little bit lower than the same note. And this is according to the bibliography we read. Because in the case of Mei school, Mei Pai, it's expected to sound higher than Chen Pai. And we can use this tool even to compare the singing style for different Hanta, different role types. Here we have just three examples of three different arias, and we have some information. For example, in the case of Tan, the pitch range is all over the first degree, so that there's no note sung below the first degree, while in the case of Lao Shen and Tian, there is the pitch range is above and below the first degree. And in the case of the extent of the pitch range, Tan and Lao Shen has a similar extent, so it's like an octave plus a third. But in the case of Jing, the pitch range is very narrow. He sings mostly three notes, and then some other ornaments and below and above that. So this could be another tool to compare the singing styles of different role types. So let's move to some other tasks. I won't explain this in such a detail, just to show you what kind of things we can do. For example, one of our researchers developed algorithm for automatically detecting where there is vibrato in a melody. I'll play a short video for that. So first of all, we have here in this plot the pitch track. Actually, let me play it. Yeah. So this is the melody, the pitch track, the melody of the whole aria. And we want to analyze these two syllables. I'll play them again. Okay, just these two syllables. Now we can zoom in the whole melody, just searching for these two syllables we just heard. And here you can see how the algorithm marked in red color where there is vibrato, and it was found automatically. So once the algorithm has found that in this region there is vibrato, it can measure different features from the vibrato. For example, the extent, how wide the vibrato is, measured in cents. Or also the vibrato rate, the speed of the vibrato, if the vibrato is fast or slow. And we can see that here, for this part, this vibrato goes for somehow narrower form to a little bit wider, or for a slower to faster kind of performance. So we can take this kind of quantitative information. This is an example of using quantitative information for musicological research and obtain these results here. This is the vibrato rate, and this is the vibrato extent. And we can see how, in the case of Li Shenzhu, the vibrato is slower and wider than in the case of Qi Xiaoqiu, We can do more analysis. For example, we can compare loudness. We read some papers and some books, and we found that in the case of Chen Pai, in the school of Chen Yanqiu, there is very typical the variability in loudness, that loudness varies a lot. So we want to measure this aspect. So for that, to measure loudness, we need to separate from the audio the voice from the accompaniment, because otherwise we will be measuring the loudness of the Jinghu or the drums. So we need only the voice. And one of our researchers developed an algorithm for doing this. So I will play two samples, first the original version, and then the version just with just the voice, without accompaniment. This is the result. Wait, there is no accompaniment here. All of you can notice that this result is not very pleasant to the ear. But the purpose is not that. The purpose is not to be listened. It's to be used with the computer to analyze this kind of tasks. So we can use this result. It can be improved, of course, but it's already usable for this kind of purposes. So from that, we can measure the loudness. Here in this plot, we have the melody at the bottom and then the loudness at the top. And here in this bar, in this chart here, we have measured the variability, how loudness varies while singing. And we can see how, in the case of Qi Xiaoqiu, there is more variability than in case of Li Shenzhu. So the loudness varies more. Another example is to compare the timbre of the two singers. We read in the literature that Mei Pai, the school of Mei Lan Fang, is brighter. So the timbre is brighter in this case. So we want to measure this timbre quality. I showed for these examples for two single sounds. Now we're going to measure the timbre of the whole singing, of the whole recording. So for that, we use this method, which is called long-term average spectrum. So brightness is measured in the spectrum by the higher weight of the higher harmonics with higher frequency. So we see this region here, where the harmonics have higher frequency, and comparing these two plots, we see that here, in the case of Li Shenzhu, these harmonics have more weight, are more prominent than in the case of Qi Xiaoqiu. If we compute the centroid, which is the central weight of these two spectrum, we see that the numbers also tell us that in this case, there is more weight in the higher harmonics than in this case. We can compare it in this way. You can see the blue line is the performance of Li Shenzhu, and the red line is the performance of Qi Xiaoqiu. And we can see here that the higher harmonics have more weight that in the case of Li Shenzhu than in Qi Xiaoqiu. Okay, these are the kinds of analysis we can do from the different segments. We computed automatically from the area. And now we can do other kind of analysis. For example, this is analysis of tempo. Here, we have a representation of the tempo in the whole area. At the beginning, there is a Bashi Daoban, which is 3 meter. So we don't compute tempo there. We start from Manban. And this is a case we have here where the tempo goes down, very typically. Before the actors start singing, the accompaniment does a recital tango. So if we can compute the beats and then plot this tempo curve, we can see here how this ritardando occurs very easily. And then we can also see for the whole area the changes on tempo. If we compare the performance of these two actresses, we can also see that Xavier Caro has a more stable tempo to the performance than in the case of Li Shengzhu. Of course, our final goal is to be able to extract from this information the pan shi, so to identify automatically which pan shi is sung. Here, I will use another aria as an example. This is an aria for Feng Huan Chao. And this is the whole tempo curve. So this aria starts with Yuan Ban, and is singing Yuan Ban until this point, here, this point. And then it changes to a small instrumental section, and then changes to Liu Shui. We know that Yuan Ban, in the case of Tan, a roll type, is a 4-4 meter and medium tempo, and Liu Shui is a fast meter with 1-4 tempo. But if we look here in the tempo curve, we see that there is not much difference between these two pan shi. So the way of telling apart these two pan shi is to be able to plot a pan curve, so to measure the tempo of the pan, only the downbeat. And in this way, we can say, we can see very clearly that this region is a Yuan Ban, and this region is sung in Liu Shui. And if we are able to do that, we can also measure the exact point where there is change of pan shi. So we can see here that Yuan Ban changes to the instrumental section at 22 BPMs, and here changes in 83 BPMs. And we can use this to compare the performance of the same pan shi in two different areas. For example, in these two areas, this part is in Liu Shui. In the case we saw just now, the change is in the 83 BPMs, but here it changes at 43. I have to say that we don't have yet this technology. We're working in this direction because it's very hard to tell the computer the difference between a ban and a yen, a downbeat and upbeat. So, but this is a research we're taking. So now, this is the work that Zhang Shuo is doing about the relationship of tonal linguistic tones and melody. So I'll let him introduce this, of course, and he will do the rest of the presentation. Thank you.
Similarity between the linguistic tones in the lyrics of Beijing opera and the melodic contours in this music. So basically, the idea of a tone to melody similarity is present in almost all of the original Chinese operas. So if you consider all these varieties of Chinese operas, you'll find that the dialect of that particular opera is very important in shaping their melodic contour characteristics. So the basic idea is that because Chinese languages are tonal languages, each syllable identity is tied with a particular pitch contour shape. So in order to be more intelligible in the singing, the opera singers have traditionally arranged the lyrics to the melody so that people can understand better, basically. So in this case, we're doing this research project for several reasons here. The first one is, of course, it is obviously an important topic in the Beijing opera research. It is a classic topic that has been carried on by many musicologists and linguists over the past century without much of a concluding results. One of the difficulties is that if you want to analyze this music and the tones by hand, you will have to look at one contours at a time, and the things that it turns out that you can't go very far before you just lose track of what is really happening in this data. So in that case, the computer is exactly the good thing that can help combing through a large amount of data in a very short time, and it allow us to extract patterns from big database. So the second motivation would be to explore ways to, not only ways, but also quantitative and data-driven ways to study the similarity between language and music. So how the prosodic aspects of language would affect the music making. So with that being said, there's also other challenges within this particular task. So for example, the second point here, the idea of dialects, because as a well-known fact, that the historical development of Beijing opera involved both the Beijing dialect and the Huguang dialect. These two dialects have different tone systems. They both have four tones, but the tone contour shapes are often different, except for the first tone. So in that case, how can we tell which tone is playing a bigger role in shaping the melodic contours? Fortunately, what we do in this project is that we don't really assume anything about these two. So we purely look at the music data from a data mining perspective. So then the last point is about another challenge here, which is that what do you mean, or how do you define the term similarity in this case? So it turns out that in order for you to perceive or identify the word, it's not necessary that you have to hear the whole tone contour, even in language, but in music more so. So here we consider two types of similarities. The first type is the single syllabic similarity. In this case, we only consider one single syllable. So how, as a unit of similarity, so how similar is the melodic contour to a linguistic tone contour when we consider the shape of the contour, the pitch contour in a single syllable. That is very direct. But then we also consider the second possibility, which is that we don't require the single contour shape to be that similar. So in this case, we consider a pair of syllables. So in other words, two words. In these two words, it doesn't have to be the case that the shape of the contours reflect that of the linguistic tones. We only require that the relative pitch heights of these two words would resemble that of a pair of linguistic contours. So for instance, if you have a first tone in Beijing dialect followed by a third tone, then obviously first tone is higher than third tone. In that case, if we observe that in the melody, the first tone is all, the first tone's melody is also higher than the third tone, then we consider that similarity to be true. So obviously these two kinds of similarities also require very different methodologies to deal with. But I will not go into detail with that. But in this, so next, we talk about how we prepare this data, and then we very briefly talk about the methodology and results. So to start with, you have to have lots of data that are structured. So that's why we need to annotate these recordings with many, many different tiers. Not every tier is shown in this slide here. So basically, the idea is that first you need to segment the whole recording into syllabic units. So each segment here is one word, or in Chinese, one word corresponds to one syllable. So that's the same thing. And then notice that on the first tier, you have actually the second tier there, you have the pinyin form followed by a tone mark. So the first ones, these four, would be a fourth tone. So in that case, these annotations are done automatically using a implementation of a Chinese character to this form of pinyin transformation. So that is very convenient. At this point, the segmentation is done manually, but if we want to go beyond that, in the syllabic level segmentation, we need to improve that technology. So a bit more about the methodology. On the upper left corner, you can see a very crude representation of what we did with a pitch curve. So basically the idea is that if you have a pitch curve, it would look like the blue one on the upper left corner, which is a very complex curve. And if to do this kind of work, we don't really need that level of detail. So what we do is that instead of using this originally complex contour, which would also be slow for the computer to process, we simply use a technique, a time series data mining technique called the symbolic aggregate approximation, which converts this complex curve into a symbolic string. So this curve would be here represented, as you can see, by CCFCBECF, or something like that. So this would become a very short string of symbols. And if we have thousands of curves, pitch curves, contour curves, we're able to process this data very fast. So some initial results on the single syllable versus the pairwise similarity indicates that single syllable similarity is very low. So as we can see on the lower right corner, each bar corresponds to a tone. So there will be tone 1, tone 2, tone 3, tone 4 from left to right. You can see that the shapes are pretty much the same. So blue would be a flat shape. Green is a rising shape, and red is falling. So each tone has a pretty uniform distribution of shapes, which is not what we expected if we expect to find high degrees of similarity, in which case you would have, let's say, the first tone would be all level, and the second tone would be all rising, as in speech you would find. So this also is confirmed with this plot on the lower left corner, which is a average curve of tone 1, tone 2, tone 3, and tone 4, computed by a smoothing spline, a Nova model, which is, I'm not going to go into detail. But because this model has very limited power, I would be very careful to infer the shape of the majority of the tones from this average curve. But it, nonetheless, it's good to know. On the upper right corner, you can see that the result for the pairwise similarity is reasonably higher than the single syllable. In this case, we achieved by different models, we achieved a 70% of accuracy to predict the relative pitch heights of a pair of syllables from a linguistic tone information. So in this case, I think it's fair to conclude that the pairwise similarity is more is higher than the single syllable. So what else can we do from the lyrics? One task, very natural task, is to align the lyrics with the audio. So in this case, the task is very straightforward. You have a recording, let's say this area, and then you have the lyrics for this whole recording. You know that they will, all these lyrics will occur in this recording, and you want to find a match between the lyrics and the recording so that you know where each sentence position in the audio recording automatically. So in this case, let's play a little video to demo our result. On the first and second tier, you can see this is the correct answer. It's annotated by a human. In the fourth and fifth tier, you can see a result that's computed by our algorithm. The markings are the detected boundaries or aligned boundaries for each word. So in this case, you can see that the result is reasonably is very accurate for practical purposes. One of the things I would like to point out is that in this work, we used, if you use the score information, then you can get a better accuracy, about 10% of improvement. So similar to that case, we can also do a search of a subpart of the lyrics. In this case, it's technically it's a different task because in that first task, you know that the whole passage will occur in this audio recording and you just try to match it. But in this case, it's a scan. So you have to scan the recording for the part that you're gonna look for. So it looks like that. But another problem that we can conceive on this type of task is that in Beijing opera, it is very common to have different versions of lyrics. Different artists, at times, they could arrange their own lyrics for various reasons. So in this case, if one of the lines is not really sent in the recording, then obviously we cannot match it. We cannot match everything. But then, as an application of this, you will be very quickly be able to find all the different versions of lyrics from the same area in your collection. So that is a possible application of this. Next, let's move on to another topic, which is the computing of melodic similarity. So, Beijing opera is a very structured music. By that, I mean that each line, each phrase of the melody is structured for instance, in this way. So here we see a 3+3+4 line. And this is sung as a couplet. So here we see two couplets. So what is expected is that each column here would belong to the same structural position. So that means that they would be expected to have a similar melodic shape. So first, of course, let's get rid of the first line, because the first line is of a different rhythmic type, and not fair to compare that with the rest. So now we have these lines, and let's see if we find what we expected in terms of melodic theory similarity. Let's take these two words. These are in the same column, so theoretically we expect them to have a very similar shapes. So this is what they look like. Visually, they do look very similar. And indeed, that is the case if you listen to it. But what's even better in this case, in our method, is that you have a number there that tells you the degree of similarity between these two melodic contours. So in this number represents the distance between these two contours. So what that means is that if this number is zero, so it's very low, that means that they're very similar. They're basically the same thing. But if it's a very high number, it means their distance from each other is very high. So they're very dissimilar. So let's look at some other examples. So let's say these two would both belong to the second line of a couplet, in which case we expect to find them very similar. So in this case, yeah, it looks similar. But notice that the number is a little bit higher than the previous one, although it's not probably not significant. Another example here. These the two segments belong to very different positions, structural positions in the line. So we expect them to be very different, and that is indeed the case. What's more, we find that the distance, that number is very high, and it's visually very obvious why they're so different. So that was a comparison of a single actor. But we can also do a comparison between the different actors. Let's say we take the both of the same segments, same words from both these artists, and then we take a look at their contours. So in this case, because they're this, in the same structural position, they're exactly the same words, they are very similar. But although notice that the number is much higher, almost 10 times higher than when we compare the curves from the single artist. Let's take another example. This number is very high. So we have the ability to compare any pair of segments. So why don't we just compare all segments and see what comes up? So in this case, we have a what we call a similarity matrix, in which the color, degree of the colors represents the degree of similarity. So in this case, you can see that the more towards the blue end, we have a high similarity, and towards the red end, we have a low similarity. We could take any pair from these two artists and examine only one part of this matrix. Let's say we take 2A with 2A again, and it's the lower left corner, 2A and 2A. So what happened? Okay. So we can see that this is very blue, so that means it's very high similarity. These two are very similar, and that's exactly what we expected. So let's take another example. We take 3B from the first artist and 2B from the second. Both are Bs, so Bs are the same structural position, and we expect to find more or less similar. But in this case, you can see that it's a very red color in that grid, which means it's very dissimilar, very different. That is somewhat surprising, but consider these are the different artists, we could make sense of that. Of course, we don't try to interpret that. That's the word for musicologists. So this is what they look like. And the distance is very high, as you can see. So the next task is somewhat similar to what we talk about in lyrics to audio alignment. In this case, we have the score to audio alignment. This task is, the definition of this task is also very straightforward. You have sections of the scores. Of course, the scores should be in a machine-readable form, not on paper. And then you want to match that with sections in the audio recording automatically. So how can we achieve this? A reasonably easy way to do this is to convert the score into the MIDI representation. Score has precise information about pitch and durations and rhythms, so we can easily convert that into MIDI. And then we can try to match or search for the segments in the recording that could match, optimally match that MIDI representation. So let's see how this would look. It looks reasonably well matched, but also notice in this case that there are some notes that are not really in there, not in the recording. It's in the score, but not in the recording. This is a common problem that in Beijing Opera, the usefulness of score is limited because all of these scores are basically descriptions of maybe one version of the performance. There's no reason that we expect that everyone will sing exactly the same way as that score. So let's say take the second actor and we compare, and we also find that there are some differences. And also notice that in this case there are some temperament differences too, because we're not really sure that Beijing Opera is using the same temperament as equal temperament as the MIDI. So next, if we flip that process, so we went from the score to the audio. In this case, if we flip that and we go from the audio to the score, that's what we call automatic transcription from the score. So in this case, we have our goal to transcribe automatically, producing this score from the audio recording. This is a very hard task. So what we try to do to approximate that first is to use the intermediate representation with the MIDI again. So let's see how that works with the video. So the challenge here is to transform extract from the continuous melodic curves into this discrete pitch levels, with duration for each pitch. So that is a representation, and let's see how well that did with a synthesized version of flute. That sounds good. Let's also hear it from the piano. So it looks like we do have a reasonably accurate representation of both the pitch and the duration for each note. But that is certainly, that is very good, but it's not enough for automatic transcription, because what we need is to extract from this very precise logical relationship of rhythms. So that is a very hard task, partly because a human performance would normally deviate from a very precise meter or rhythm that the score usually has. So in that case, this is one of the biggest challenges in the automatic transcription. So last but not least, we introduce a demo that shows our final product that has all of these functionalities that we have described. It's a collection of tools, and it is a exploration and discovery browsing tool for music collections, and it's called Dunia. So let's see this from a little video. So you can see that here we have all sorts of information aggregated into this tool. First, we have this automatic segmentation, which shows the different rhythmic passages, 导板头 and 导板. And then we have metadata information, album and artists and the rest on the left side, which is extracted automatically from the music brains. So now the singing starts, and we see the lyrics, and we see a, of course, we see the melody, and we also see a transcription of the pitch heights on the right side. Of course, that also shows the pitch histogram. So with this type of tools, we'll be able to better serve the users and the music lovers as a more meaningful and deep and not an analytical way to explore and discover more music. Okay. So that was all the specifics, and now let me welcome Professor Serra for the final concluding remarks.
Okay, thank you, Zhang Shuo. So I guess from this presentation, you saw many things. A lot of things is work in progress. So. Clearly, there is some work to be done yet, and we didn't go into details of a lot of the technical things behind it. But I want to emphasize as concluding remarks, even though clearly there was some musicological interest in all this work, and I think it's a very interesting thing that we can use these tools for musicological research, and we hope that it's useful. Still, the core is that out of that, we would be able to improve the techniques for automatic analysis and exploration of music collections that is relevant not just for musicologists, but for every all the people that are interested in appreciating this type of music that, as I said, requires some analytical thinking and requires to really appreciate some of these nuances that at first listening are not so obvious. And I guess you realize that these are very complex problems. In fact, the field of MIR, as we talked about, focuses on these issues. In fact, we basically went over a lot of the current research challenges that are within the field of MIR by using Jingju music as an example. And so these are a lot of researchers are working on these, and the specific case of Jingju music, there are not that many. So we definitely require the collaboration of people to really advance in this research. Doesn't mean that you have to be really a researcher doing a PhD to do this research. There's a lot of things that a lot of people can contribute to make this type of research to be useful for everyone. So we need, of course, researchers, we need musicians, but we need a lot of data and a lot of information that can help us do this research. So as I said, the goal of this trip is precisely to familiarize the people about this type of research, to encourage maybe students that might be interested in doing research in this, and to identify possibilities for your research that you might be interested in. This talk, in fact, today we did, I believe, a pretty good recording, a video recording of it. So we will be putting it on the website, on this one, also with the videos and information about it. On the website of CompMusic, you will find articles and information of other things we have done, tutorials, lectures about the different music traditions. So feel free to go through that. Also even about the software tools that we talked about and the data sets that we talked about, and even this prototype, the Dunia prototype, which is very much in its infancy. We don't claim to be that the substitute of iTunes, far from that, but at least that we are starting to put some ideas that might be relevant to be added to some of these tools. So anyway, so feel free to go through that. And with that, basically, I want to finish. And of course, thank Rafael and Zhang Shuo for their presentations. And more importantly, to acknowledge that behind this, there is the work of a lot of people. Research is one of these tasks that requires teamwork, that requires collaboration, that requires very much of open type of collaboration. And this is very much the spirit of the project. All our work is very much public. All the software is very much open software. And with that, we hope that we can all improve in this research, and we can make something useful for Jingju music, but also for the music of around the world. And with that, I would like to thank you very much.
请问大家那个现在有什么问题吗？可以及时的和三位主讲人进行交流。没有吗？ Okay.
Very detailed question. According to your announcement, firstly, thank you very much for your fantastic representation. And I'm as a designer, I'm very excited to have a look at the image you made from music, from the analysis you have done, because there is a saying goes that architecture is the aesthetic kind of music. So you achieved it, or you magnified the you amplified that kind of contour. So but my question is not about all of that. It's that when you refer to Paiban and the Manban, I wonder what's the fallacy of that? I mean, how many temper in a minute will you define it as Paiban?
Yep.
You can.
I don't need a mic, right? Everyone can listen. Can you hear me? Yeah. Thank you. Well, as I said, this research is still, I wouldn't say in progress. We haven't started really doing this. So this is a plan to do. First of all, with this information, we don't have it. We need to get it from musicologists. We cannot provide this information to them. It has to be the other way around. Or what we can do is to have a very accurate annotation of this data, so we can take many areas, annotate it manually by specialists, saying this part is a Manba, and this part, and this part, and this part, and we can take all of them, and when you can take the information from there. Yeah, but this is very hard because, as I said, there is a difference between ban and yen. So we have to know where is the downbeat and the upbeat, and how to tell the computer to this, to differentiate these two different kind of beats, is still a research question that we have to tackle in the future, hopefully in the close future. Yep. Thank you.
So you mean to recognize the song that different people sing?
Material. Maybe they, by violin, maybe by trumpet, maybe by people, maybe by...
Okay. Clearly the concept of recognition of a song can be related to many aspects of the music. There is the current technology, the state of the art, there is a technology that allows to recognize any song using timbre features, these very low level type of features that Rafael mentioned. So what is called fingerprinting, it's a technology that is in fact commercially available, and that there is a number of companies that you can put your mobile in front of a speaker and it tells you what song is being played. That exists. But that uses one type of information, which is very low level, and that requires the company to have a recording that you are playing. So it has a huge database of recording. You can recognize a song according to different types of features. There are some things, for example, you can play a Beatles song, but maybe change the lyrics and just maintain the chords. So you need to recognize the chords to recognize that it's that piece, that song of the Beatles. Maybe you use, instead of a guitar, you use a piano and still it's recognized. And of course there is this other option of trying to recognize what instruments are there. We are not doing that because in our case we know what instruments are there. So, I mean, it's a complex issue, depends on what you want to do with that and what type of music you do. So one of the biggest, for me, ideas behind this type of work is that there is no solution in a general way. We won't be able to solve any of these problems in a general way for all the musics of the world. We have to look at every music, understand what its characteristics are, and then develop technology for that. Given that, we also know what we want to do with that. So there is a lot of different approaches that are being used for different types of music with different results, but there is no single solution. But I didn't quite understand your question, but that can be done, of course, but depends on, for maybe for our, is not so relevant, for other types of music it is. By the way, you can ask in Chinese too, because today we gave the talk in English, but we normally do it in fact, except me. They speak in Chinese and then I translate. So if you want to ask in Chinese, I just talk.
I want to
train
my
oral
English.
Okay, very good. We are studying these five music traditions, these two Indians, Turkish, Beijing opera.
In China, I'm sorry.
Oh, within China. Oh, okay.
We have country and Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I know a lot. A lot. I would like other people to have those plans. We have started this. I believe it's a good start. And the problem from our approach, it requires every tradition has to be studied in a separate way. I believe like Kunju might be easier from this work. In our project, we don't have any plan. One of the reasons, again, we are here, we would like to encourage people to see the relevance of this type of approach to analyze these music traditions, and then other people would do it. Every research takes so much time, so much effort, that a single person can, or a single team cannot do everything. So we would really love to have plans to study other traditions. Currently, we do not.
There are several other types of singing besides nianbai, what we chant in Peking opera, such as, nianbai is another kind of, when people just speaking in daily language. So is this kind of speaking also pattern or has some distinguished features? And how do you treat this in your analysis of the opera?
We are focusing on the arias only. We are only focusing on the singing part. The spoken part. Yesterday we were in a Beijing opera, and I really realized the spoken part, how interesting prosodically he is, and how interesting it would be to work on that too. But we are not doing that. Maybe do you want to say something about that? But I am sure maybe the approach that that Zhang Shuo did could be applied. I don't know if you want to comment on that.
Yeah, I think the approach could be basic. But of course, what we need to, of course, first, as Professor Serra already said, we need to look at each problem and then analyze the structure of this problem and then define what methodology, or even first define what task should be appropriate to really solve this problem. We cannot, of course, just using our methodology to tackle any problem. But with that being said, I believe that some of these time series data mining techniques would be very useful for tackling speech prosody problems that may arise from there. But myself, I'm not really familiar with the speech part in Beijing opera. Maybe you want to say something?
No. Of course, we're not claiming that Jingju music is only chang duan. So Jingju is a very complex art form. There is a lot of qipai, instrumental qipai, that very interesting to work with from a musicological part. Nianbai is amazing, how to compare different role types and to study the Beijinghua and Huguanyin there is very obvious. There is many things to do with Peking opera, and then the relationship with the music, with the movements, for example, and input video. But then we could never end. So we just focus on the arias, and we already have a lot of work to do there. So
yeah, in fact, is when you are not in this particular research field, maybe it's difficult to realize how much effort is behind this, but. Like even on the kind of things we talk, there is like 12 PhD theses involved there. And this is on what you would be considering a very narrow thing. So it's huge. Well, in China there are a lot of people, so it would be easy to tackle all these things and solve them quickly. Maybe in Europe it's harder, we need more people. So anyway, we definitely need more people to work on this. Any other?
Thank you for your speech. I'm very excited because 5 years ago, I started research on the traditional Chinese musical score. And at that time, some Chinese musician tell me that Chinese music need improvisation, and we only teach people by the traditional oral way. So you can't analyze the Chinese music by the computer, not as the same as the Western way. And at that time, I feel alone, and now I'm not alone. So I just have a simple question. For the syllable analysis, we may need some ground truth data so that we can estimate how estimate the precision of the algorithm, which is the syllable recognition. And that means you may need some data, which is well segmentation, and each segmentation have been labeled to indicate the type of the syllable. So how to get that data?
People doing it.
Are you talking about the linguistic at home and music similarity?
Yeah.
Yeah. Right now we annotate it by hand.
So
I talked about our segmentation was by hand, but then you can annotate automatically.
But before you run your algorithm, you must know how. What is the ground truth?
No. The ground truth is done manually.
Okay,
so we do everything. So
you label the syllable manually.
Yeah. So for most of this work. And maybe for people that are not familiar with the approach on machine learning, you need ground truth. You need data that you believe is the right one. And then the computer can learn from that. Okay. So most of these systems, when we say that the computer does something, it's not completely true. I mean, if someone does something, and then the computer learns from what that person has done. Okay. So, but to do something so that the computer understands what you have done, it's not easy, because you have to do it on the language of the computer. So that means that most of these problems have required people, mainly PhD students and other people, to manually label or describe, or to say, this is a voice section, this is an instrumental section, this is a drum section. And out of that, that's what you call the ground truth. And then you learn from that, and then you can annotate other things. And then you can use the ground truth also to validate that your algorithm works. So for the case, a more painful type of annotation is this syllable level segmentation that takes time and
So that's hard work.
By ground truth, you mean like which tone each syllable is, right? So yeah, so that is true, that the segmentation is done by hand on the syllabic level. But then we can put in the labels automatically using a Prof script. So the process is that because we know each area what it is, and then so we can find the lyrics for the whole area, and then we put in the labels only for the accompaniment. So because there are relatively few accompaniment segments, so instrumental segments. So I just put the AC over there. So then I can easily use that lyrics that we have. And of course, I also talked about the converting from the Chinese characters to the automatically. To the pinyin representation with a tone mark in the end. So that can be put in automatically.
But the problem is, I guess what you're referring is more for the task of lyrics to audio alignment,
that's
for example.
What I thought.
And for the lyrics to audio alignment, we basically do what speech people do. So you have these annotations, but in our case, we have a very big problem that we don't have recordings of singers isolated. And so to have a ground truth, ground truth, we would need to have a data set with Beijing Opera singing completely isolated, that then you annotate manually, in which you can train your hidden Markov model approach or some other approach to really develop the timbre models for that. So then you can do the segmentation, phonetic recognition. So we do not have that.
we do not have recordings, what we would call a cappella, from which we could even do the annotations. So that's a big problem.
So do you have any data which is well labeled the syllable?
We have some songs. That data that Zhang Shuo showed is label syllable. How big is the data set that you have?
30
arias that are segment at the syllable level and label everything. And we can supply that to clearly everything is available.
Thank you.
Yes.
I have another question. When we focus on the musical score of Jingju, I'm wondering how you transform the numbered musical score into digital form. Because as far as I know, there is some research on the musical score recognition, but they usually focus on the staff, but not the numbered musical score. So how to do the automatically transform?
Well, so you mean to synthesize the score?
Yeah.
Yeah, for me, sincerely, when I started this project, I thought that this was not a good problem to work on. Because in Western music, it's okay. People read from the score. It's what is called a prescriptive score. So you have the score in front of you, and you play from that. So it makes sense, the task of trying to substitute the performer, which I don't think is possible, but anyway, and then have a computer to play from the score. In Jingju music, people do not play from the score. Jingju music, it's an oral tradition in which there are scores that are descriptive and are never used to play from. So the concept of playing from a score is not, from a musicological, musical, cultural point of view, I don't think it's a meaningful task. In other traditions, it is. So I think that's a very important thing that engineers, we have to be aware and be careful on doing things that make sense for a given tradition and that do not distort a given culture or a given tradition. So it's possible, but I don't think it's that meaningful. Well, it's not possible because I think it's very difficult, but I don't think it's good even to think about it, let's say.
In Zhang Shuo's speech, you want to get the musical score from the audio data?
Okay, the truth is that we don't, but what we want to do is to compare a given recording with a given score. And in order to do that, you have to have technologies that approach the two, so that go from the audio to kind of a score, and from the score to kind of the audio, so that they meet halfway. And then you can find the differences. So it's more a way to compare score and audio than a way to go from one to the other. I think it's good to compare the two and see there is this score and this actor is playing something different. So you can compare the two. So
To do that, we also need the ground truth score. So how to get that score? Automatically or
good. For that, you need a musicologist to do a transcription. I mean, these scores that we have in Jingju music, they have been done by musicologists, by listening or by the same artist, actor, no, by transcribing what they have done. So you could start from that, but you need a transcription manually done. So that's again an annotation problem. From that particular recording that the musicologist tells you, according to the consensus of musicologists, that's a meaningful transcription. And then you can learn from that. But that would be specific for that recording. And then you can use that to, that we would like to do. We are doing that in some other traditions. In the Arab Andalusian music, we have a musicologist that is doing exactly that. That would be a good task to do. But first, we need to hire musicologists to transcribe, according to them, those particular recordings, and then we could work from that.
Thank you very much.
非常感谢三位主讲人非常精彩的讲座和回答。接下来呢就想有一个小小的请求想跟大家说一下，就是在6月13号的时候呢，中越学社会有一场专场的音乐会。那么我们现在是在小酱油这个平台上正在筹集赞助。这个小酱油平台是这样的，大家扫这个码，然后点击微信账户登录之后呢，就是大家可以在页面下方找到送酱油的一个小圆圈，然后点击那个小圆圈之后呢，就是小酱油平台，大家点一下之后，那个平台会赞助我们1块钱的这个资金。然后呢，就所以在这里就恳请大家用微信扫一下码，然后那个支持一下我们的音乐会好吗？谢谢。这个音乐会是它的主题叫《样国乐》，其实更多的就是包括一些像怎么说呢，就吹管乐和打击乐的一些小的组合的一些曲目，当然还包括一些乐团大的曲目。然后如果大家感兴趣的话，我可以就是把我们学社平台的那个微信的二维码拿出来，大家如果有感兴趣可以看，我们最近会把相关音乐会的消息发到那个平台上。谢谢。如果扫不了的话，可以到前面来发一下。